the blood of Jesus do something about that also? Does it only provide atonement for us, or does it also deal with the constant cleansing of our soul from all sin? That's the issue we are talking about. I'm talking about constant cleansing of our soul, our heart and mind from all sin.
My Redeemer lives, and I will see His glory as He works all things together for my good. Whatever things occur, of this I can be sure. I know my Redeemer lives. I know my Redeemer lives. My Redeemer. My Redeemer lives, and I will see His glory as He works all things together for my good. Whatever soon will fade as His glory is revealed. My Redeemer lives, and I will see His glory as He works all things together for my good. Whatever things occur, of this I can be sure.
John chapter 1 and verse 7. But if we walk in the light as He is in the light, we have fellowship with one another, and the blood of Jesus Christ, His Son, cleanses us from all sin. Today I want to talk about how the blood of Jesus Christ cleanses us from all sin. Cleanses us from all sin. Now this is different from the forgiveness of sin, which is redemption. Forgiveness of sin brings us back to God, makes us children of God. Our sins are forgiven. God does not see our sins. He sees us in Christ. That's forgiveness of sin. But this is something, cleansing is something that happens after the forgiveness of sin has happened. 1 John is an epistle written to the believers, and to those believers, John is saying, the blood of Jesus Christ, His Son, cleanses us from all sin. What sin is he talking about? He's not talking about the forgiveness of sin through which we have redemption or reconciliation with God, where we have come back to God and become children of God. He's now talking about something that happens after our salvation experience. He's talking about the cleansing that we constantly need as we live in this world. As the pollution of sin affects us in our life, and how we need constantly the cleansing, and that cleansing is available to us through the blood of Jesus Christ. Now it's like this. You know, as we live in this world is full of dirt and dust and filth. And, especially in the place where we live, You can keep all that windows closed tight, doors closed tight, curtains in place, basically insulated from all kinds of dirt and filth. But still, you'll have layers of dust and filth on all your equipment and all your stuff if you don't keep on cleaning constantly. You got to keep on wiping and cleaning constantly, because you can never be free from the pollution and the dust and the dirt and the filth that comes flying in the air somehow. It's all over the place. It comes in through some little crevice, some little gap, somewhere it finds, it seeps in. Even if you cover it with sheets and stuff, still it gets underneath and you find it dirty underneath because the dust finds the way inside. Now sin is like that. The sin's effect upon our life is like that. We live in a world. The world is full of sin. The world embodies all the sin that there is. There's plenty of it. It's like the filth and the dirt and the dust that is all around. You can never be completely free from it in the sense of not have any of it on you. It's like dust. It just comes and settles on your mind, on your thoughts, on your desires. Somehow, as you live in this world, you will find that sin somehow has a polluting effect on you. It pollutes you in some way. I'm sure that every one of you finds it to be true. If you say, no, I don't have any sin, then the Bible says that you're a liar. Every person finds the pollution of sin affecting them in some way, in their mind, in their thoughts, in their desires. Somehow it seeps in. You may not do any great sin. You may not go and commit a sin as such or do any acts of sin, but still you can be polluted by sin. You can be polluted by sin, the impurity, the defilement, the filth and the dirt that the sin brings somehow gets in into our heart, into our mind, into our thoughts, into our desires, into our conscience. In that realm, it somehow gets in there and affects us very much. And this issue that we are talking about is about that. It's not just about the forgiveness of sin. It is about this pollution that sin brings about. And how that it's a constant issue. It's not just a one-time issue. It's a constant issue where you have to deal with it. And the blood of Jesus cleanses us from all the pollution of sin. That's the way I'd like to say it. From the pollution of sin, which we constantly need it. Now, the Bible talks about cleansing in the Old Testament and in the New Testament. I want to look at the Old Testament first, then we'll talk about the New Testament, the cleansing as it is taught there. Then only we can understand this whole issue of how the blood of Jesus cleanses us from all sin. That's what 1 John 7 says. The blood of Jesus Christ, his Son, cleanses us from all sin. In order to understand the cleansing, you need to understand cleansing taught in the Old Testament and cleansing taught in the New Testament. Now look at the Old Testament first. In the Old Testament, whenever somebody wants to come to God, two things needed to be done. One, the person has to bring an offering for his sin, to remedy his sin. It's a sin offering. He has to bring an offering to set right this sin issue. He cannot come to God. God is a holy God. Man is a sinner. And God has declared that the soul that sins shall die. The wages of sin is death. So that punishment of death has to be served. Man cannot come to God without that. Now, the cross of Jesus Christ and Christ's death on the cross is all about that. How God took our punishment that he declared that the wages of sin is death and placed it upon Jesus instead of placing it upon us so that he may give us life. He gave him death so that he may give us life. Now, that was picturized or that was acted out or enacted, so to speak, in the Old Testament through the sin offering, through the atonement they made for sin. They'll bring the sin offering, they'll kill the animal, shed its blood, and the high priest will take the blood and into the very presence of God and sprinkle it upon the mercy seat, thereby obtaining the forgiveness of sin for the sinner. So a man approaches God with a sin offering. He has to make atonement for his sin. That's a big issue. The second thing that the Bible teaches in the Old Testament is about cleansing. It teaches it as a separate issue. If you read it, Leviticus chapter 13 and verse and 14, chapter 13 and chapter 14, and Numbers chapter 19. Now, Leviticus and Numbers are usually books that are avoided by people. The very names scares people away from those books, you know. And the stuff that it talks about also seems boring as soon as you read it, but it's very meaningful, really. It is all about sin, the issue of sin. If you look at it like that, it's all about sin and Christ and salvation and the cross. It's all about that. You know, you should look beyond all the sacrifices and the bloodshed and all the procedures and the methods employed and so on at the real issue which it's teaching about. It's all about sin. It's all about the remedy for sin, God's way of salvation, and so on. That's the way it has to be taught. So if you read Leviticus 13 and 14, in Leviticus 13 and 14, you read there about how if a person dies in a house, the people in the house are considered as unclean. And they have to go through a whole purification process. If a man touches a dead body, or if he is present when a person is dead in a house, in a place where the death has happened, if he's there, it's enough. He's considered unclean. Then he has to go through a whole procedure cleansing himself from that uncleanness. Why is death considered so unclean? You know, it is considered unclean because, you remember, death came as a result of sin. It has some association with the sin. And to teach how sin is unclean, how sin pollutes, this was taught so that people, when they are in the presence of a dead person or when they have touched a dead body, they're considered unclean. They have to go through a whole procedure to declare them clean in order to allow them to get back into society and move around and relate to others. You have to go through a whole range of procedures. First, they have to bring an offering for sin, and then they have to do some cleansing with it. They have to kill an animal, burn it, and take the ashes and mix it with water and sprinkle it on the person. I mean, the procedures are amazing. Why, you know, such elaborate procedures were given is a question in the minds of a lot of people, but it's all a teaching about the pollution of sin, how sin pollutes, and pollution of sin is not an ordinary issue, that it has to be dealt with. And later on, when you come into the New Testament, the Bible teaches that the blood of Jesus cleanses us from all sin, meaning the pollution of sin. Similarly, if you go to Numbers chapter 19, there it talks about leprosy. Leprosy is like death in those days. And a leprous person, a person who has leprosy, is considered unclean and he's put away, quarantined from people and for so many days. And he's checked out, and then the whole procedure is followed to declare him clean. He has to go bathe himself, and then they'll have to bring two little birds and kill one bird and put its blood in the water and take the blood and put it upon the ears of the leper and so many places on his body, in his ears and his legs and hands and so on, you know. And when people read this, they get tired of it. They say, oh, I don't understand any of these things. It's all about the pollution of sin and how to deal with it. Now, how can I say that? How can I just say that it's all about sin and the pollution of sin? Turn with me to Hebrews chapter 9. Hebrews is all about explaining the gospel from the Old Testament, okay? If you don't understand the Old Testament properly, you will never understand Hebrews. And understanding Hebrews helps you to understand Old Testament. So the two go together very well, all right? So if you know Old Testament already, it's going to help you. If you don't know Old Testament, Hebrews is going to help you understand the Old Testament. So let me read to you Hebrews chapter 9, verse 13 and 14. For if the blood of bulls and goats and ashes of a heifer, sprinkling the unclean, sanctifies for the purifying of the flesh. Now it's talking about blood of bulls and goats and ashes of a heifer. Now you read about all of this, all of these things in Leviticus and in Numbers, you know. You read about particularly Numbers chapter 19, you know, about these things. So it is actually referring to the Old Testament cleansing procedure. And it says, if the blood of bulls and goats and ashes of a heifer, as it was done in the Old Testament, referring to Leviticus 19, sprinkling the unclean, sanctifies for the purifying of the flesh. If it was used as a procedure for sanctifying or cleansing in the Old Testament times, how much more? Now listen to the comparison. How much more shall the blood of Christ, who through the eternal Spirit offered himself without spot to God, cleanse your conscience from dead works to serve the living God? If the blood of bulls and goats and ashes of a heifer was used to sprinkle the unclean back in those days so that he can be cleansed and purified in the flesh so that he can be declared clean. If that cleansing can happen like that under the Old Testament, how much more the blood of Jesus, which is offered on the cross of Calvary, cleanse our conscience so that we may serve the living God, or so that we may live for God. It's talking about believers living for God. How much more it can cleanse our conscience and help us and aid us in living for God, it says. So clearly, the Old Testament cleansing procedures were all about how our heart has to be cleansed, our conscience has to be cleansed, so that we may live for God. The whole issue is about that. Only when you understand that, then you will have you'll make out any meaning at all with those chapters over there. Now let me take you to Psalm 51. Now you know Psalm 51, the context in which David wrote that psalm. It is given to you right there in the beginning. If you have a good Bible, it'll start by saying Psalm 51, and then underneath there is a paragraph before the psalm begins. It says, to the chief musician, a psalm of David, when Nathan the prophet went to him and after he had gone in to Bathsheba, after he sinned with his woman called Bathsheba and killed her husband so that he can take her. It's a terrible thing that happened. Bathsheba's husband is a soldier, and a very faithful soldier. He's fighting there for the king in the war. He's ready to even give his life for his king, very loyal to the king. And he puts him in the front lines of the battle, planning to kill him, have him die in the war. The king does it, you know. And the guy is killed because this man likes that man's wife, Bathsheba. So he has committed two wrongs. One is murder and the other is adultery. Both things happen, big sins. Now after he has sinned in this way, a prophet named Nathan comes to David and points out to him what he has done and convicts him in his heart about the wrong that he has done. And he's totally convicted, and he now, as a singer and a composer, composes this psalm in that circumstances. So here we have Psalm 51, a very interesting psalm. I'm going to read a few verses from here, maybe 10 verses from here. Maybe most of you have read that, but maybe you have not thought about it like that. But you will see there that psalmist is crying out, pointing to God about two issues. One is the sin, the transgression, the wrong he has done. Two things he has done, murdered and committed adultery. Both are wrong. So he is talking about his acts of sin. But then he talks about the pollution that sin has brought about in his life, the filth that has gone into his mind, the dirt, the filth, and the kind of wrong things that has gone into his mind, the impurity, the defilement that has gone into his mind. He recognizes that. So he wants God to not only forgive him for the transgression, the wrongdoing, the two wrongdoings that he has done, but also deal, more importantly, with his impurity, with his defilement of his mind and heart, the dirt and the filth that has gone in, that has made him what he is, that has caused him to commit this great sin. Now that's why I want to read this psalm, because he deals with these two issues are different, two different things. One is the act of sin, but then there is the pollution of sin, which is a very real issue. A lot of times it is overlooked. That is why it is not only enough to talk about the atonement for our sins, that price has been paid for our sin, that he took our death so that we may have life. It is important to talk about it, but that's not enough. It is not enough to deal with sin in that way. It is important. But then, after that is dealt with, then you got to deal with this issue of the impurity, the pollution, the dirt and the filth that has come as a result of sin and that has stained our mind and our heart that makes us what we are. And can the blood of Jesus do something about that also? Does it only provide atonement for us, or does it also deal with the constant cleansing of our soul from all sin? That's the issue we are talking about. I'm talking about constant cleansing of our soul, our heart and mind from all sin. How many of you know the difference now? The two things are differentiated here. Now I want to read the Psalm 51 verse 1 onwards. Listen to this. The two things are coming out there very clearly. Have mercy upon me, O God, according to your loving kindness, according to the multitude of your tender mercies. Blot out my transgressions. Wash me thoroughly from my iniquity and cleanse me from my sin. I acknowledge my transgressions, my wrongdoings, in other words, and my sin is always before me. Against you, you only have I sinned and done this evil in your sight, that you may be found just when you speak and blameless when you judge. Behold, I was brought forth in iniquity and in sin. My mother conceived me. See, when he talks about sin, what sin is he talking about? He's talking about how sin has polluted him even since birth. Even when he was in his mother's womb, the pollution of sin has come upon him. Adam's sin and the effects of that sin, the dirt and the defilement and the impurity and the filth of that sin, how it has gotten into his personality, into his heart and his mind, even in his mother's womb. He says, my mother, I was brought forth in iniquity, and in sin my mother conceived me. He said, Lord, I got a real problem. I did this unbelievable wrongdoing, this terrible thing. I shouldn't have done it, but I've done it. Why? Because iniquity has been a part of my life ever since I was in my mother's womb, he says. I was brought forth in iniquity, and in sin my mother conceived me. Sin and the pollution of sin, the impurity of sin, the filth of sin, the dirt of sin has been a part of my life ever since I was in my mother's womb, he says. Behold, you desire truth in the inward parts. Now he declares a very great truth. I mean, this psalm can preach for many weeks, you know. This is one of the great psalms. He says, you desire truth in the inward parts. See, God looks at sin in a real way. When you stand before God, he doesn't ask you, what have you done wrong? It's not what you've done is not just the issue. You know, because some people will say, I've never done anything wrong. Now, how many of you know there are a lot of people in this world that have never done anything wrong? Because there's police. There's punishment. There's a wife at home. She will punish you. And there's all kinds of issues. So some people never do anything wrong just out of fear, you know. So just because a person hasn't done anything wrong doesn't mean he is an upright man. He has never done anything wrong. When you stand before God, the issue is not going to be, have you done anything wrong? When you stand before God, the issue is going to be something different. You desire truth in the inward parts. That means, is your heart clean?
Celebrate, Jesus, celebrate. Celebrate, Jesus, celebrate. Celebrate. He is risen. He is risen. resurrection of our Lord. Celebrate, Jesus, celebrate.
Everybody.
Celebrate, Jesus, celebrate. Celebrate, Jesus, celebrate.
Clap our hands and praise the Lord, the risen Lord in our midst.